Everybody's doing a brand new dance now.
Come on, baby, feel the locomotion.
I know you'll get to like it if you give it a chance now.
Greetings, holiday shoppers. There are now 152 shopping days left until Christmas, and I believe you know what that means. It's time for another episode of Christmas Creeps, your one-stop shop for holiday movies and TV shows all year round. My name is Joseph Wade. I will be your host for this evening. Here with me tonight are my co-hosts, Johnny Five, the human robot.
Hello.
Hello, John. How are you this evening?
I watched Money Train. And...
Yeah. Yeah, we'll get into that. And also, Mr. Bradford is here as well. Brad.
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
I watched Money Train.
you know,
so did I.
Hey, funny how that works.
It's good that we synchronize like that because I don't know if it's come out since the release of this episode. I was featured on an episode of... Ken Kessler's Sounds of Christmas podcast, and at the very end, he asked me, you know, what can we look forward to on the next episode of Christmas Creeps? And I very foolishly said the James Bond film on Her Majesty's Secret Service.
And you
That's
lied
just longer than the Bible.
You lied to them, is what you're saying.
I lied to this man's audience, and I apologize. So if you are a new listener to this episode and you were expecting a quality conversation about, you know, a James Bond feature...
Then you're looking at the wrong podcast to begin with. No, I'm kidding.
You are very much in the wrong place.
I apologize, Mr. Kim Kitsuragi, or whoever it was, for Joe lying to you.
It wasn't my intent... I knew it was in the mix at some point, so I just blurted one out. And then after the fact, during pre-production on this episode, we all looked at the running time and said, ain't nobody got time for that.
We'll get to it eventually, I'm sure.
Yeah, but we are all lazy SOBs, and we decided to watch something that was under 2 hours. Thank you very much. So tonight's episode is all about the 1995 action vehicle Money Train. See what I did there?
Yep.
Joe never lets us go anywhere. He goes on other podcasts and doesn't tell us about it.
We have to wait in the car.
You guys don't want to be on any episode where we have guests. You don't want to engage with any other podcasts out there, so I have to carry all the brunt of it, and I have to go do all the grunt work.
Well, that's because for people who host podcasts, we're both terribly introverted and without people skills.
I mean, if you want to talk about Mortal Kombat Annihilation, I'll go on the other one again.
Well, yeah, and one of these days we're actually going to do that, but it's not going to be this day. So
yeah, we're doing Money Train one. Come on, man, focus up.
Yeah. Well, before we get into Money Train, I just want to follow up with our last episode where we talked about Turbulence, and we said it was the most TBS dinner and a movie ass movie we've ever seen. And, of course, that led us down the rabbit hole of discovering that there's a whole TBS dinner and a movie cookbook, which I have, in fact, procured because I'm a crazy person who hates himself and also hates $4. But I'm looking through this book here, and there are exactly four, like, you know, dinner and a movie. You know, they watch a movie and they cook a dish based on that movie. There are four movies in here that we could conceivably do as, like, Christmas Creeps cooking episodes.
Oh,
that we haven't done
yes.
yet.
Well, we've done a couple of them. There's A Christmas Carol, Scrooge's turkey legs with crispy gruel stuffing.
I could get down with that. Go on.
There's A Christmas Story, edible fruit cake. No, really. Not great, is it? The
gonna
Flintstones.
Have to, gonna have to take a pass on that one, my friend.
The Flintstones Christmas Carol, standing rib roast with Rockshire pudding.
Okay.
It's not bad. And then finally, Trading Places, celery, the root of all evil, soup with pork belly croutons.
Ooh.
I like that because it ties into the plot of the movie with the pork belly.
Yes.
That is very clever.
Also a good movie, also sounds like a good dish.
Absolutely, yeah. And for reference, the Christmas Carol, the Scrooge one, it is based on the 1938 version of A Christmas Carol.
Huh.
I mean, we could watch Harold Kumar Christmas and just eat a shitload of White Castle.
We definitely could. I mean, good luck finding White Castle around here.
They have frozen White Castle, don't they?
You know what? You're absolutely right.
Just for that extra added layer of sadness.
I mean, let's see. The nearest one that I know of is in St. Louis.
I mean,
I wasn't really doing anything important tomorrow.
Let's call a spade a spade. You could probably, with a budget of $20, a trip to a grocery store and 2 hours, you could probably whip up a pretty good facsimile of White Castle in your own home.
Oh, 100%, yes.
You just buy one of those things of the buns that are all stuck together. You get, what's on a White Castle burger? It's like onions and sauce, right?
Yeah, it's like a tiny little square of hamburger meat, a couple of onion flakes, and a little bit of secret sauce, which may or may not actually be Thousand Island dressing.
Yeah, that's what I was about to say.
If it's not getting made by somebody who's not getting paid enough to care, but they are getting paid, does it really count?
You can give me $5 and I'll make them.
Okay.
See, it's more delicious when capitalism's involved.
The sad stink of desperation is involved, yes.
The delicious flavor of money. Hey, speaking of delicious flavor of money.
Oh.
Hey, speaking of murdering your wife, Robert Blake is in this movie.
I was wondering how long it would take to get there.
I think Joe was trying to initiate a can check.
I was, and then J-Man just steamrolled right over me, much like a money train.
Because nothing stops the money. If we've learned one thing in this film, it's that nothing stops the money train.
Nothing stops the train, which is also a lesson I learned today when I had somebody out to the house to tell me about air conditioning units. And he had tried to sell me a train. I'm drinking another No Santa Sloop Brewing IPA because it's all I have in my fridge.
Lovely. And
I'm trying to get rid of it.
The greatest motivator for drinking.
I mean, it was this or, I'm not kidding, almost year-old Leinenkugel Oktoberfest. Should probably get rid of those.
Just putting that one off until you have no other choice, huh?
I mean, I might as well go for the one-year anniversary.
I suppose, yeah.
anybody else want to grace us with a can check?
I have another kombucha.
Oh, really?
It's a Health Aid Cayenne Cleanse. It's spicy. It's good.
A cayenne cleanse?
Yeah, it's got, like, cayenne pepper in it. Ginger. Let's see. Yeah, ginger, lime, and cayenne pepper. It's good.
That sounds like it'll clean you right out.
Oh, yeah.
J-Man, do you have a frosty beverage to tell us about tonight?
Ooh.
Yeah, fuck both you college-ass motherfuckers. I'm drinking High Life.
Yeah. Well, now I feel like I should.
Look at me. I showed up to class multiple times.
Oh, boy. Hey.
I should clarify, speaking of Robert Blake, Karen's not dead. She just played Skyrim and fell asleep.
As one does when playing Skyrim.
We weren't concerned until just now when you said that.
Well, yeah, I realized I segued into speaking of murdering your wife. I was like, wait, I have a wife that I didn't murder. I should specify that.
Just for clarification.
Before someone tries to, like, put the pegs together on their bulletin board about us.
Someone tries to only murder us in the building us about whether or not one of our former hosts is in fact alive.
Vision board. Oh, well.
Well, tonight on the podcast is kind of a birthday boy's choice.
Yay! Another trip around the sun for Joseph.
Oh, I wasn't talking about me.
Oh?
No, this is an episode.
Karen! Karen! Come here.
No,
are
this
you,
is.
Are you putting Karen on the pod just so
yes.
that.
Just to prove that you're not dead, that I didn't murder you.
Don't wake up your wife. She's
already
asleep.
Awake. No, okay. She's already awake.
All right, hi, Karen. All right. Bye, Karen. I'm sorry. What the hell was I saying? Oh, yeah. Yeah, this is a very special birthday celebration because the star of tonight's movie, Woody Harrelson, has a birthday on July 23rd. And as it happens, so do I. And that's not necessarily why we chose Money Train, but it is a fun coincidence. Really, the reason we chose Money Train was because we had, you know, three action movies lined up that we could have chosen, and it was the shortest of the three.
Because we're lazy.
Sometimes it really is that simple. And now, having seen Money Train, I still don't know if that was even the right choice.
It's too long.
The movie we chose for being the shortest was still way too long.
This movie is 100 minutes, give or take.
Yeah.
Oh, man, the middle sags so much.
So we'll talk about plenty of problems with Money Train tonight. But I think the long and short of it is, right up front, you already know what you're getting into. Okay, Wesley Snipes and Woody Harrelson are going to rob a train full of money. Like, that's just baked into the cake.
It's on the movie. It's the name of the movie.
It's the name of the movie. Money Plane is a movie that exists. We got Money Train, and I'm really hoping that they finish out the trilogy with Money Automobile, because that would just be the chef's kiss on the whole thing. But no, they're going to rob a train, and it takes them roughly 70 or 80 minutes to get to the robbery of the train.
It's ridiculous how long it takes for the actual thing to happen. I'm a man who can appreciate a good slow burn. Hot Fuzz is my favorite movie. This movie takes too long to
but
get
I mean,
to
that,
it.
That'd be like if Hot Fuzz was instead called, like, Shootout with a Bunch of Weird Townies.
Yeah, exactly, right?
Because, like,
right.
If this movie wasn't called Money Train, like, if it was called, like, some kind of pun on transit cops, you'd give it a little more, like, slack, probably.
Absolutely. I think it's just, like, a buddy cop, 90s buddy cop film. It's fine. But the fact that they set your expectations for there to be, like, a big money train heist, the first opening scene of the movie, or is it the first scene? We're in the control room of the transit system.
Right.
It's like, okay, here's Chekhov's control room. This is where it's going to go down. This is going to be like half the movie is like them trying to stop them doing hijinks with the train. Nope.
And the second or third scene of the movie is Woody Harrelson literally saying to Wesley Snipes, hey, we should rob the train. And then it just never comes up again.
It's so frustrating.
What idiot called this movie Money Train and not Undercover Brothers?
I mean, it's okay, that's very good. I was gonna say Money Train is a great name for a movie, and it sells the concept, but you gotta where's the beef? You gotta execute. You can't just call it Money Train and not have half the movie be about the Money Train.
Yeah, like Money Train is such a snakes on a plane level title, and it really takes its sweet time getting to the money train.
Oh my goodness.
In Simpsons lingo, they only barely make it to the fireworks factory.
Yeah.
Oh,
there's
man.
There's a lot of train adjacent action, but is it the money train? No, it's
no.
not.
There's a scene inside the money train that has absolutely no purpose other than to get to establish that there are cops on the money train and fucking, I don't know. I don't know what's doing here. We're getting a little far afield. So, Bradford, I'm going to ask you to... We're not going to play the money game tonight, because I don't...
The money train?
The money train game. Because I feel like we're gonna any one of us is going to lose the plot very quickly.
Oh, my goodness.
So,
okay.
Bradford, I'm going to ask you to start, and we're gonna play this game of telephone together.
All right.
We're gonna make this work.
So I'm not trying to do it as fast as possible.
No, you're just trying to make sense of it because I feel every new detail that enters into the mix further complicates things in a way that it doesn't need to.
I think I can distill it down pretty well.
Okay.
You gotta help me with some of the dramatis personae
a
little bit.
I got you.
Okay. So we have two brothers, John and Charlie. They're foster brothers. They're played by Wesley Snipes and Woody Harrelson, respectively. Did I get that right? See, I know actors. John is sort of more the straight man, whereas Charlie is sort of a goofy guy. They're transit cops. They do a lot of undercover work. They work in New York City, the Big Apple. And
I think if we ever got tired of doing Christmas movies, we could just pivot to doing movies that take place in New York for no goddamn reason.
I feel like we'd have to know a lot more about New York City, but yes, that is absolutely a deep well from which we could pull. Where was I? So, they're transit cops, and Charlie is a degenerate gambler. Yes, exactly. Yep. That's the phrase I was going to use. And he gets into a spot of trouble with, I guess they're supposed to be the mob? I don't know.
It's either mob guys or it's bookies or it's just people that he owes gambling money to.
Bad dudes. Mob light. He owes them $15,000 and he does not have that money. He is short.
I just want to say, if I was a cop and I owed people a lot of money, I'm already doing things that are not what cops should do by owing people a lot of money for gambling debts.
Seems like a bit of a conflict of interest, doesn't
it? Well, I was just saying, if you're in for a penny, in for a pound, just shoot the asshole.
Oh, yeah, I guess I need to actually get into that plot point, because that sets up it sets up the big bad. The opening scene that introduces these characters in this movie, Charlie is acting like he's drunk. And these two kids steal his valuables, and that is the sting operation. They chase the kids through the subway. Well, they apprehend one. They chase the other kid through the subway tunnels, bringing us to near train misses. I kept a tally of near train misses.
Oh, no.
So I have three categories. I have near train misses, and then a subcategory of that is extremely close. These are all three categorized as near misses.
Okay.
Because they're chasing this kid through the tunnel. They stop all the trains because the police are in the tunnel. But then we cut to the control room where it's Patterson. Did I get that right?
Yeah, Robert Blake is Patterson.
I'm batting 1,000 here.
You're knocking him out of the park tonight.
Question is, Robert Blake always a fucking psychotic asshole in everything he plays?
Yes.
Because it just seems like of all of the people who aren't acting in this movie, which is Wesley Snipes and Woody Harrelson, they're not acting as in they're just playing themselves. Robert Blake is the most just fucking playing himself.
I mean, yeah. I mean, like the two other like big things that most people know him from are the Truman Capote film In Cold Blood, and then David Lynch's Lost Highway, where he plays like a literal crazy person. So, yeah.
Where I know him from is not being found guilty of murdering his wife, but losing a wrongful death lawsuit about it, and The Little Rascals.
So he was in The Little Rascals, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Those two things juxtaposed together are just... What a picture you paint with words, my friend.
Robert Blake was Mickey in The Little Rascals. The fun things you learn about films when you're doing a podcast.
Movie magic, ladies and gentlemen. All right. Where was I?
So
they're chasing the kid through the tunnel. They've stopped all the trains because they're chasing the kid through the tunnel. But Patterson demands that the money train, which, for those of you unfamiliar, in transit systems, I feel like this is less of a thing now with a lot of, like, payment being digital, but it's probably still a thing. In transit systems, they'd use a train to go around to all of the different stations to collect the fares that were sort of collected that day.
Right.
They do the same thing with garbage, fun fact. They have a garbage train as well. They're in the same just like the same chain.
You can pay for train fare with garbage. That's a see. New York City really is the most progressive city in the world. I love it.
City of dreams. If you can make it there, you can make it anywhere. That's what they tell me. So,
call it the Big Apple because you can pay for stuff with Apple Cores.
3 a.m. So
day after Christmas.
they
You guys know what just strung together in my head, right?
Go on.
Greg has to go get an abortion because there's a brain growing in his stomach.
Oh God!
I mean, just explain the joke—a mashup of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and the Benfold's five-song "Brick."
Yes. Oh man. Oh dear, I never put those two together, but we've done it. Krang's a brick and I'm drowning slowly.
Oh my God.
Oh dear. Oh no.
Speaking of day after Christmas, that is very much the time frame that we're talking about in this film.
Yeah, so I think a little bit of it happens before Christmas. The big action is New Year's Eve, but yeah, we will get to that.
Yeah, it's kind of the week between Christmas and New Year's.
I am trying my darndest to get us to here. So we have Patterson.
Yes.
He's an asshole. He runs, I guess he's like the transit guy?
I would say he's probably head of like MTA, maybe.
It's so weird because he has like this weird like megalomaniac mob boss thing going on, but it's like, dude, that's not your money. That's the transit system's money.
So Wikipedia calls him the transit captain.
Transit captain?
Which means that John and Charlie report directly to him, right?
Yes, he fired them, so I sure hope they report to him.
That is very much like not the vibe that I got off of their interactions at all. Like, he struck me as a guy who like the transit authority is working with and not for.
Well, I mean, with the way he acts, yeah, he acts.
Yeah,
it's weird. It's very strange.
You get the feeling that he's a boss, but not necessarily their boss.
Right. He's probably their boss's boss or whatever. Like, is the implicate.
He struck me as a bank manager that is telling the police what to do. Essentially.
Yeah.
That may or may not be it, but eh.
So anyways, he's very concerned about the money train collecting all of the fares, so he demands that the money train keep moving, despite the fact that there are people in the tunnel. So the money train reaches the next stop, and the armed guards get out, because it's a whole armed guard situation. They've got, you know, semi-automatic rifles and whatnot. Oh, yeah. And this kid, John and Charlie are chasing this kid, and he runs up to all the armed guards, and they kill him.
They immediately assume he's going to rob the money train.
They shoot him full of a lot of bullets, and he is dead. And John and Charlie are upset about this, and they start a fist fight with the armed guards. And that brings us to Patterson's office, where he chews them out and is introduced sort of as the big bad. It talks about the money train, how nothing stops the money train. That's his money. You stop the money train, you have to come to me. I'm gonna kill you dead.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways.
Don't fuck with my train again.
Yes. They steal the toy train on his desk, which is a nice touch.
Mm-hmm.
Charlie pockets it on the way out. And they joke about robbing the money train, and we are like 10 minutes into this movie, and I'm like, okay, here we go.
You set up the heroes, you set up the villain, you set up the stakes, you set up the heist, like boom, like it's very efficient, and then loses the plot immediately for the next hour.
Oh, it's so frustrating because you know,
Jennifer Lopez shows up.
Yeah. J-Lo shows up. She's great. She's a new transfer. So we get a lot of, like, character development and interaction between the three, because Charlie has a thing for her, but she has a thing for John. she and John end up becoming an item. Charlie finds out and sort of kind of takes offense to it, but they're brothers, so they're, you know, it's the whole bros thing.
Yeah.
The other thing of note that happens is John gives Charlie an envelope with the $15,000, and he's pickpocketed on the way to go give it to the mafioso. So he's out of money, and basically the mob guy is threatening John because Charlie really doesn't care. He's like, okay, go ahead and kill me if you're gonna kill me.
And then do you remember the part where we said John is Wesley Snipes thinly playing himself?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so Wesley Snipes just roundhouse kicks them all.
Yeah, he goes into the mob hideout or hangout, whatever, and just kicks the mob boss straight through a plate glass window.
It was very good.
Like you
did.
It
was a good kick. Because he referred to him as a racial slur earlier in the film, and then he calls back to that, and then immediately kicks him through a plate glass window. It's good.
Yes. There's also another thread running through here about a serial arsonist.
Yeah, and that gets wrapped up before even the big action. So there's a serial arsonist called the Torch.
Played by a guy who I'm amazed we haven't seen in anything so far.
Yeah, played by Chris Cooper, of all people.
Yeah, like, how the fuck did he avoid being in anything we've seen so far?
I have not a clue. Nary a clue.
Because I looked at immediately as soon as I saw him, I was like, oh, it's that guy. And I'm like, no, he hasn't fucking been in anything we've seen. What the hell?
I know. I mean... He's been in a ton of things that you definitely have seen, but nothing that we've covered here on the show.
Yeah, I checked the cast list, try to see if we could up the list here. We got a couple people into Double Trouble. Big Pussy's into Double Trouble now.
Oh, okay.
And I want to say Nelson Vasquez or one of the other randos is.
Okay.
Maybe the guy who plays Kowalski.
That's you're getting a little granular with our actors.
Yeah, so it's just sure. they've also been bit parts in like fucking another shitty 90s action movie we've watched. Basically.
I gotcha.
Yeah.
There are a lot of featured extras that are pushed out of the way in this movie.
Yes.
Yeah. Notably,
so many people getting pushed out of the way.
Oh my god. Yeah. And like notably. I guess you'd call them featured extras. You get Dean Norris and...
It's the dude who, again, is not Joey Pants, but is doing his best to look like him.
Oh, Enrico Colantoni, who I only know of through Galaxy Quest. He's Matt Cesar in Galaxy Quest.
Something a little stranger is the original writer of this was... the fucking Die Hard 2 original writer, Doug Richardson.
Huh. Oh, really?
Yeah, and then Tony Scott was actually going to direct it, but then when Tony Scott left, the new director kicked Richardson off when Joseph Rubin came on.
Oh, and so they just rewrote it and just went about their merry business?
Yeah.
That kind of explains a lot of the middle part of this movie.
Oh, yeah, the middle part.
Because the middle is very much like, hey... do you love Wesley Snipes and Woody Harrelson? Do you love seeing them together? Where here's a whole lot of that. Where they're just kind of doing their buddy shtick off each other.
Yeah. It's setting up the stakes because there's a couple pieces that need to be put in place, but it takes so long to do it.
Yeah, to get back to the arsonist, it's kind of the inciting incident with them getting kicked off the force. Before that, there's a scene where they get a couple more pieces of information, which one of them I didn't quite understand. They said that because of the rate hike on New Year's Day, the biggest day of the year for, like, subway fares is New Year's Eve. Because
everybody buys a bunch of tokens before the rate hike goes into effect.
Okay, I see. That explains it. Okay.
And also, presumably, a lot of people are traveling the subways to get to Times Square and back again on New Year's Eve.
Right. Okay, yeah. And then they also established that there is a grate on the bottom of the money train on the floor.
Because they're helping out on, like, Christmas for some reason on the money train because some of the staff had to do whatever on Christmas.
They had COVID.
Yeah. So we have these sort of all the pieces are in place now It takes far too long to get there, but
yeah, they get kicked off the force.
They're both fired. For and then...
what happens is that this is another thing. This I don't get why they I get but don't get why they were fired. I just want to walk through this. So they're on a stakeout where they have Grace posing as a toll booth operator because the torch, the serial arsonist, is basically going up to toll booths like he has a hose full of gasoline and is just squirting gasoline through the token slot, through
and
the money slot.
Women.
Yes. So they have her in the booth, and John is like being the lookout, and there's a couple other cops staking out. Because of their earlier run-in where he got away from them the first time he set a booth on fire, he recognizes Grace. So he pushes somebody onto the tracks, and it distracts everybody except for Charlie, who wasn't even supposed to be there today. Who's now his lookout, and he sees that the guy has the lighter and rushes out shooting and scares him off. And somehow, and then eventually what happens is Wesley Snipes kills him.
Yeah.
But it's
yeah.
like, why was he blamed for what exactly? For not letting Jennifer Lopez get set on fire?
I think there was a line of dialogue where, because he like shoots his gun a whole bunch. He's like shooting wildly into the subway station and he breaks windows and like
who gives a shit about glass?
I know, but like I know it's tenuous, but like he basically caused a big ruckus, and then the thing with the horse and the kids, I guess they thought that it was too much chaos or something. I don't know.
But also it's a part of it is that the torch arsonist shoved a guy straight in front of a train and forced the entire system to shut down. And why wasn't Charlie there to stop that? And then, you know, because then the money train has to stop, and nothing stops my money train.
Yeah.
Therefore, fuck you, you're fired.
So he gets fired, and John comes up to Patterson chewing out Charlie and tells him off, and then Patterson fires him as well, essentially.
Right.
So everything is set up at this point. Charlie is in debt and doesn't have the money. They're both fired from the force. They know about the money train. And so Charlie essentially tells John in so many words with a gift that he's going to rob the money train.
Mm-hmm.
And John, being the brother that he is, goes to essentially stop/assist Charlie. Kind of.
I mean, he's going
a little bit of column B.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to try and stop Charlie because he knows this is like a death sentence if he gets caught.
Yeah.
Because you saw what happened to that kid at the beginning of the film. He got shot dead for doing nothing.
Yeah. So then, with 20 minutes to spare in our runtime, we finally heist the money train.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. There's a train full of money in this movie? Tell me more.
Called the money train.
It's called the money train, and it is a train with money on it, and they take the money on the train. But Charlie's plan to hijack the train is to literally just get on the train and hijack it and take it with him.
He slides under the train.
It's
just
really
lays
not
down.
Yeah,
it's really bad. It's a really bad plan because he like walks right in front of the train. They probably could have seen him. He lays down on the track, lets the train run over him, and then uses a torch to open up this grate. This is the only good part of the plan. All of the armed guards get out at the station to go collect the money. So he uses that opportunity to kick the one last guy off of the train and then just takes off with the train.
Yep.
Yeah, and again, established earlier when they were running through there, they saw that there were some construction workers working near like an access grate, so they're like, oh, also, you know, we can just, you know, stop the train there, hop out.
Yes, and that is what he does. Is he thought enough to bring a torch, but didn't think enough to bring a duffel bag. So he grabs like four bags of money. One of them has $500,000 in it, and it's really small. I don't think money is that small.
It's full of doubloons. Yeah, that was that's the take from like the Port Authority station. Some pirates came in,
and I'm sure one of the bags is just full of gold bars from the heist from Die Hard with a Vengeance. Like, you're not moving that bag. You just got to leave it there.
Because Because what is the largest U.S. denomination? It's 1,000, right? Or is it 100? I always get this wrong. What's the biggest bill?
Thousands do exist, but they're, like, exceedingly rare, and they're mostly used for, like, Federal Reserve stuff, right?
Yeah, it wouldn't be thousands. So it'd be hundreds. So there'd have to be...
Well, then why did you ask if you knew?
I'm doing math. Okay, maybe if they were all hundreds, he could fit it in the bag. But anyways, he grabs a couple of bags worth about, like, $1 million total. And he climbs up his ladder to the grate, but there are horse cops in the park where he wants to get out. So he freaks out and jumps back down. And now the plan's gone bad.
Foiled by the Central Park Rangers. God damn it.
Yes. Yet again, another Christmas movie where the Central Park Rangers swoop in to ruin the day. So at this point, John shows up and tries to convince Charlie to not steal the money. And then a big cat and mouse game ensues, which should have been more than 10 minutes of the movie. Should have been like 30. Could have cut out some of the middle, you guys.
Like, you would assume in a film like this, and I guess, you know, the Ocean's 11 remake kind of pioneered it, where is giving us a scene where they explain what the hell the plan is while we get to see them actually execute the plan. You know?
It doesn't even have to be that. It can just be dumb action stuff, but we don't even get that much of that, you know? It can be the train breaking through more barriers and them doing other stuff to try and stop the train, like they did.
Yeah, like there's, because we get like two or three real sequences where they try to stop the train. Like, oh, they put up the brakes to force the train to stop. Well, they just crashed right on through that because they cut the brakes. They put up the barricade. They crash through the barricade. They have a line of cops there to just shoot the train. Well, that fucking doesn't work.
There's like so much. There's a lot of wasted potential here too, because you have a whole subway system, but this train only ever runs on the A line.
Right.
Like, you gotta there's so many things you could do with this. You can have them switch over to another line. You
can have them drive the train to Pennsylvania.
Go to a, like, jump aboard a different train while two trains are running next to each other. Switch trains.
They rail the train onto a ferry.
Come on. Yeah, take a train to Long Island. I don't know.
I'll say this: the one clever turn they took in during the train sequence was the train went so fast that it caught up to the train in front of it and is now threatening to derail that train, which is a passenger train.
Oh,
so money train.
So they crash the money train, and they get out of the money train because they jump onto the passenger train before it crashes. And they run into Patterson, who's having a freak out because the money train is empty with no people. Well, it doesn't have any people in it. And he's flipping out and he's looking through the crowd trying to find the perps. And who should he find but Charlie and John?
Yep.
Who say, oh, we came as fast as we could to help. And then he berates them again. And then they both do the team up punch.
Good stuff.
And then Grace arrests him because he threatened the lives of all the people on the passenger train.
Right, and she wasn't so much a witness as she was. She heard it on the radio.
Yeah, I mean, well, when you hear the guy going, "Oh, that's going to kill a lot of people," I'm fine with that. It's like, no, yeah, I mean, pretty cut and dry.
Yeah, that's fair, and I'm sure she wasn't the only one listening in too.
And then they walk out of Times Square as the ball drops. And come to find out, Charlie did take some money and move and scene.
It was crammed into his person.
Yes.
Oh, boy. So some minor details here and there that I want to touch on real quick. This is the second film we've covered in a row that has featured It's a Wonderful Life. Did you guys catch this?
I did not catch this one.
There is. So the scene where Charlie's been let go from the force and John has basically cut him out of his life. Charlie has then gone to their dive bar of choice and he's getting drunk with the bartender, and the bartender tells him, "You've had enough. No more Jägermeister for you, sir." And then up on the TV is the scene of It's a Wonderful Life where George Bailey meets Clarence for the first time. And if I'm being honest, it's the one of the only really clever bits in the film, because it's very much a similar scene where the bartender is basically trying to save Charlie from a grisly fate by drinking himself to death.
Very clever.
It's more clever than in Turbulence, where they just kind of throw It's a Wonderful Life up on the screen.
Just but for like, flavor.
Just for fun. Just for funsies. But here they actually like went to the effort of finding the one relevant scene that had something to do with the scene they were putting in it. And I appreciate that.
Good job, movie makers.
That's called filmmaking. What else is there to talk about? We got pinball machines. We could talk about some pinball machines for a hot minute.
We got three. Mm-hmm. They are in the bar.
Yes.
J-Lo
is featured playing one of them.
She's playing the games.
Yes.
Now
here's a difficult thing for us. Early 80s and older, as far as pinball machines go, we are neither academically equipped to discuss, nor do we really particularly care.
There are some decent late 80s ones, but no, it doesn't hold a candle to 90s.
Yeah.
Pinball.
So
yeah, I mean, if the name doesn't end with Knight or Knight 2000, give me a few years and I'll start caring about it.
Yeah. We got the games, we got Meteor, we got a third unknown one that I was trying to identify and just straight up couldn't.
It's the name is Mars.
Yeah, the name ends with RS.
Okay.
And it looked like a rocket ship, so I think it's something Mars.
Listen to my typing as I go to the Internet Pinball Database.
You and me both, sir. Is it Revenge from Mars?
It is not Revenge from Mars.
No, it can't be. You're right. It can't be.
That's too early.
It is.
For starters.
Oh,
also,
boy.
The back glass doesn't look like that.
Nerding out about pinball. I love it.
I mean, I'm sorry. Have you quality seen content. Show before?
I have, and I was being serious when I said that.
Quality content right here.
Putting it in your ear holes for free. Not asking for a single red cent from coffee or Patreon or nothing. This is out of the goodness of our hearts. I want to talk about the arsonist for a hot second, because it seems like that is meant to be a bigger part of the film than it is, because
yeah.
It's really just two scenes. Like the
yeah,
scene
and
where the arsonist kills his first victim, and then the scene where they stake him out and actually catch him and kill him.
Well,
he doesn't kill her.
Kill that yeah. lady. They pull her out and
you're right, because they say off camera that she survived will survive her injuries.
Yeah.
Okay. But I guess it should also be noted that like 2 days after this film was released, somebody actually did that to somebody in the subway station.
Oof.
And yeah, and a lot of people tried to pin the blame on this movie and tried to get it pulled from theaters.
And the street was like, what the fuck ever? We stole it from something that happened in 88.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think I got your. Yeah, no, they based off of the original crime that the scene was based off of was something that happened in, like, the late 80s.
Hmm.
All right, folks. Well, I think what we're coming around to is that Money Train has a lot of nothing to offer anybody.
Yeah, I mean, it's not something that I'm going to make a point to come back to and watch again, but I didn't have any problems with watching it the first time.
Yeah, it's if you're here to see Wesley Snipes and Woody Harrelson make jokes and be assholes to each other,
already watched White Men Can't Jump and Wildcats.
Yeah, I mean, you're gonna have fun, but like, if you're coming at this from the angle like we are, like, oh, this is a Christmas movie, isn't it? I don't know about that, sirs.
Yeah.
And that's as good an opportunity as any for us to jump straight into the crankometer, where we can rate this and give our honest kind of opinion about Money Train. The crankometer, if you're just joining us, is our patented XY axis for rating Christmas movies. That's how we do things around here, where the X axis is the Christmas quotient, how Christmassy a film is, and the Y axis is how good a film is. So, gentle friends, the Christmas quotient for Money Train. What you got?
One. So, this doesn't use Christmas basically in any way of the plot.
No.
Except for the planned date for robbing the money train is New Year's Eve, which is not Christmas. But no. It's the holiday season.
And John's Christmas gift to Charlie is to try and pay off his gambling debt. That's not
right.
Nothing.
That's not nothing. That's true, but it could have been his birthday.
True.
I think it would have been a real easy replacement for all of these plot points that are with Christmas to be not Christmas. I think this is one of those films that just happens to fall on Christmas because it's interesting. It does look nice. I like all of the mid-90s Christmas decorations. People decorate their booths in the transit system. Everything's done up.
You get some lovely aerial shots of Rockefeller Center with the giant tree and everything. Looks nice.
The big old pit that everybody skates around in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It really does kind of land in the kind of Shane Black territory of like, well, Christmas lights are just pretty. And they that's the only great reason we need.
Yeah, they look great in night scenes when they're blurred by being in the background.
Right.
It's a good look.
Mm-hmm.
It evokes something, I think. Yeah.
See, I'm either going to land on a zero or a one because, like, on the one hand, like, yeah, it's just there, but it doesn't make either particularly good use of it. But it is, but then it doesn't misuse it either. So.
Yes,
but
mainly,
there's I almost the only reason I want to go with a one is because there's so much of the decoration.
Yeah,
there's so much of it. It's everywhere.
I gotcha. Yeah, it's kind of an overload.
And they make a point to establish why it's taking place at the end of the year too. So
yeah,
I mean, it's not completely arbitrary.
That's true. They at least an effort was made, I guess, is what we're saying.
There was an attempt.
There was an attempt. Yeah, one is fine. I'm fine with a one, but quality, the y-axis. What are we gonna say about this? I hesitate to give this. I don't want to give this a negative score because I didn't outright dislike it, but I'm not a big fan of it either.
I would almost go a nat zero. It's fine. Maybe one. Like John said, I didn't hate my time with it, but I will not seek it out or recommend it to anybody. It's fine.
Yeah. It's the platonic ideal of what like a dumb 90s action movie should be. And like literally doing anything to improve it will only make it a better movie. You know?
Yeah, there's a lot of room for improvement. Like we said, the middle just drags on, especially when you set up all of these pieces at the very beginning. It's just mm-hmm. like, get to the point. This movie either A, could have replaced some of that stuff in the middle with more train hijinks, or B, could have been a good 15 to 20 minutes shorter.
Yeah.
Like one of those two, take your pick.
Money Train could have either been about the arsonist suddenly deciding to rob a train and they have to stop him, or just don't include the arsonist at all.
Yeah,
you know,
there could have been an easier way to have them fired for the force, or just don't have them fired from the force, and maybe Charlie just decides to do it because he's the wild card.
Here's another question I have.
Yeah, he did cut the brakes after all.
Exactly. Thank you. I'm glad somebody got that reference. I was gonna scream wild card bitches yeehaw, but I thought maybe I'd save the mix.
What was I about to say? Oh, right. Another question I have is, why make them cops at all? Is it just to have like the irony of, oh, cops robbing a train?
I guess. I mean, it's just to have the buddy cop sort of
dynamic, I guess. I could see it being necessarily the premise of them being able to know so much about how the shit's working, but they could easily just be any other like subway employees for that matter.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
That's true.
Maybe not sandwich artists, but like the other subway.
Yeah, subway workers who decide they want to get in on a piece of that money train action. Like that.
Easy.
We kind of veered over into Santa's workshop here, didn't we?
I will say, because this is a mid-90s R-rated movie, I'm happy that they included a sex scene for no reason because it's R-rated.
It's so gratuitous. Like, there's absolutely no reason for that to be in there.
The one thing I am confused about is how there is exactly, like, a grand total of 1.3 seconds of, like, Jennifer Lopez titty. It's like, if you're gonna actually have, like nudity, like rating nudity in your movie, why for that little? Either don't at all, or just it's like it is so little that like it's the only reason I even thought about it was because I noticed it was rated R for like nudity. It's like, okay, well,
two additional notes I'll add to that. One, that was apparently one of the very few reshoots that they did, like they added that later.
Weird.
And two, the only reason Jennifer Lopez is in the movie at all is because Catherine Zeta-Jones said, "I am not doing nudity for this movie."
Huh.
So there you have it.
Maybe they shot it just to make sure they got the R rating?
I mean, they say like, fuck enough times, though.
I guess that's true. They do curse a lot in this movie.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But I do want to say I am happy when movies include sex scenes for no reasons because somebody has to do something to like combat the fucking PG-13ization of every single fucking movie ever.
And oh yeah,
if it
yeah.
just involves titties for no reason, then all right, I like that. So fine.
Noble end.
Adults like real movies too. Fair enough. Fair enough. Is what we're coming down on saying we're going to give this positive marks for nudity? Is that what we're saying?
A Christmas no, creeps first.
Not necessarily, because it's just another sign of it being like just one of those like medium range like 90s action movies.
True.
I mean, I think I read that Woody Harrelson and Wesley Snipes both got paid like $5 million each for it.
Whew. Yowza.
Ay caramba. That's for the 90s, that's a lot.
That's a hefty chunk of change.
Yeah, but at the same time, this wasn't like some like, you know, gigantic production either, because like those are your two top stars basically, and you know, you're looking at that's probably like, you know, 25% of the budget, which is probably that's how movies end up these days anyway too. Mm-hmm. Or just you're paying that star about $40 million instead. So,
yeah.
So, like, I don't see the budget on here, but I would guess this movie probably cost around, like, $40, $50 million.
Do you want me to hit you with it?
Pull budget, the numbers.
Budget $68,000. There it is. How?
Million.
Yeah, $68 million. How when you only spend $10 million on the two stars?
Got a lot of practical effects.
Yeah, they did say they built an entire, like, full-size subway set in Los Angeles. After it was determined that actually shooting on location in the subway was unfeasible.
Yeah, there's too much running through tunnels and destroying tunnels and other things.
And only grossed $35 million. Ouch.
Yeah.
Wah, 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 wah. When did it come out? Did it come? It was summer. It was a summer blockbuster, right?
No, it was November 26th. This was actually a seasonal movie.
Interesting.
a seasonal appropriate adult Christmas action comedy question mark. I mean, I appreciate the effort certainly, but
yeah, I want to give this a zero just because it did a lot of things that you kind of want to see a dumb action movie do. It just did them all very half-assedly.
Yeah,
half-assedly and out of order and for no apparent reason.
There you go. It's to bring the sandwich analogy back. It's like they made your sandwich, but they put all the meats on the outside and left the bread in the middle.
It's a Wesley Snipes, Woody Harrelson double down.
Exactly.
Ugh. Yeah. So we're gonna land on Money Train a positive 1-0 on our crankometer. So rack that one up on your score chart, and we will keep this Christmas money trainer rolling. Anything y'all want to add before we round out the show tonight?
Yes.
Final thoughts.
Yes. The real money train was the friends we made along the way.
So Jennifer Lopez.
Yes.
Okay.
She's Jennifer Affleck now.
That's true. I don't know how that relates to this, but that's true.
Because she posted on Instagram, she said her name is Jennifer Affleck.
So what would the shortening of that be?
Jack.
Jaff?
Jafflo?
That doesn't work.
Well, Wikipedia.
Jaff.
Jeff.
Jeff. The artist formerly known as Jeff.
Yeah, so this money train is coming into the station very slowly because I think we have run out of gas.
Nothing stops the money train.
Oh, so we're gonna welcome to hour two of Money Train Talk. I'm your host, Jim Cramer. No, I'm not doing any of that.
Double feature. We also watched The Great Train Robbery.
The Sean Connery one?
Yes.
All right. Let's all do our best Sean Connery impressions. Hey, you know what I completely forgot?
Hello, Governor. I'm Sean Connery.
I'm not doing a Sean Connery. I cannot. I won't. I refuse.
Listen, howdy, here, partner. This year, Sean Connery.
Yeah, it would be that bad.
Listen here, you rubes. I must ask you a question.
What's that?
I got him to do it.
You did. You got
me. Oh, the name is Bond. James Bond. On the Majesty's Secret Service, yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, the thing that I was going to ask you guys and completely forgot.
I was
going to ask you, if you were to rob the money train, how would you do it?
Well, we've been over this a little bit. The first part of the plan is okay, but the big mistake that he makes is he stops the money train, and as you know, nothing stops the money train. No, they have sensors in the tunnel, and he stops the money train, like, right at the entrance, like, the maintenance hatch that he was gonna use to escape. If he had just grabbed what money he wanted, and then set the train, like, locked down the gas, and set the train to keep moving, he wouldn't be in this bind. He could just wait for the horse cops to leave, and then he's scot-free. And then the money train is empty whenever it stops. Probably cause some collateral damage in the system, but they'd stop it eventually with, like, the auto-braking system or whatever they tried to do.
Woulda, coulda, shoulda, yeah.
But as we know, nothing stops the money train.
Nothing stops the money train. That's absolutely true.
So that was really his only mistake, was stopping the money train, because nothing stops the money
train. Yeah, if he had just not stopped the money train, they would have been none the wiser.
Yeah, more or less.
More or less.
I think all the armed guards probably radioed in that the money train, I mean they did, that it had been stolen. But
if only we could have gotten that scene, you know, that scene where armed guards, Enrico Colantoni and Dean Norris, have to radio in and explain that, oh, Woody Harrelson is on the train now. What do we do about him?
I thought there was going to be so much more like cat and mouse with like Patterson sitting in his little command center and like freaking out. Like, I don't know, man. There's so much like what I thought this movie was going to be and what it ended up being. Not the same things, right?
The bones of a good story are here. It's just they don't connect any of them the right way.
Yeah.
It's a monstrosity that needs to be killed.
Oh, I mean, boy. I guess I can say is there's a reason Speed only spends like 20 minutes fucking around in the subway. Because there's only so much you can do down there.
Yeah, because they knew that was a dumb as hell ending.
Yeah, I'm just saying, and the other, I can think of a couple of action movies, Speed and Die Hard with a Vengeance, that just do stuff in the subway, and both of them make it a point to not do all that much stuff in the subway.
Yeah, Because I think they both realize it is too complicated and not that interesting. And also, that's basically like watching people do terrorist shit, and no one wants to see that.
Oh, if we want to watch another Subway Christmas movie, watch Ghostbusters 2.
I mean, yeah, we could do that. The only thing better than a money train is a ghost train.
Ghostbusters 2 is a Christmas movie?
It exists in the same like week long span as this movie, where it's like it starts right after Christmas, it ends at New Year's.
I will tell you this: I've never seen Ghostbusters 2, but I remember it was on. Have I told you this story, or was I talking about the South Park Christmas special? I don't remember.
I don't remember.
I saw a lot of TV through osmosis when visiting my relatives over the holidays, apparently. I remember being really scared because Ghostbusters 2 was on the television when we were visiting my family, my extended family, for Christmas. And it's the scene with the baby in the bathtub. And I was scared for the longest time that I was going to get sucked down the bathtub.
Okay, this is like a story in the past, not like a story like last year. Okay.
No, I was like five. Yeah. Like,
or is this story from last year?
I'm still deathly terrified that I'm going to get sucked down the bathtub by a ghost.
You and me both, bud.
Speaking of sucked
really,
by a ghost.
Really, it's on that... It's on that lady for leaving her kid in the bathtub unattended. You're really not supposed to do that.
Yeah.
Remember that lil. Because that was like a lil baby, right?
Yeah.
It was like a baby.
He's just a little guy.
He's just a little guy who got sucked down the drain by a ghost.
I mean, we could definitely do a Ghostbusters 2 podcast because it was a huge summer blockbuster that fits the theme of the season. For sure.
Yeah, I mean, I think the most Christmassy it gets is there's a scene in the montage where they're wearing Santa hats, maybe.
Yeah, and then the final act of the film does take place on New Year's Eve. So,
I mean, we have done far more tenuous movies.
I mean, hell, we just did Money Train.
Yeah.
All right, we are flailing around right now, and I think that means it's time to end the show.
Yes.
So if you want to get at us on the internet for any reason, if you want to yell at us, tell us we're doing a good job, whatever you want, you can tweet at us at Christmas Creeps on Twitter, email us at xmascreeps@gmail.com, go to our website, christmascreeps.com, go to iTunes or Spotify, wherever you get podcasts, and leave us a star rating and a review, and tell a friend about Christmas Creeps, because this is the time of year when people slowly start looking for Christmas podcasts, because I guess Christmas in July is a thing.
They come crawling back.
Every time they think they're through with us, we pull them back in.
You pathetic lot. Slowly crawl, clawing your way back to us, hat in hand, for more Christmas content. We're here year round, giving it to you. You ungrateful. No.
Like Oliver Twist.
Thank you.
Like Oliver Twist before them. Our listeners come to us hat in hand and say, please, sir, we'd like some more.
I jest. We're so happy to have you. Thank you so much for listening.
We love all of you, and we love doing this show. That's why we've been doing this to ourselves for so long. And that's going to do it for Christmas Creeps. So I'm Joseph Wade.
I'm Bradford.
I'm the Money Train.
Nothing stops the Money Train.
Except the stop button on the recording.
Good night,
everybody.
Happy Christmas. Happy Christmas.